your kind of channel. Brand new to my YouTube kind of channel, please just subscribe. Hit that bell button so you're notified of new YouTube kind of video. Brand new to my YouTube kind of channel, hi, welcome. If you're not new to that channel, then welcome back. So I'm so excited and happy to film this YouTube kind of video. I've been active on this channel, well, I've been active watching other people's YouTube kind of videos, but I have been like filming, editing, uploading nothing for the past 2 months, which I checked on my phone and it's been 2 months. I said, dang, it's been that long, because usually I was from like 3 weeks or like a month or something like that to get a break. But I feel like this was like a break that I needed because I was so focused on my main channel and working and stuff, and it was just too much. So now I'm on set, I'm back from vacation, I'm back from working, I started my first day back working yesterday, and now I'm filming a true crime video. Usually up on this channel on Tuesdays, and I run my main channel of videos on Mondays and Wednesdays, and this channel on Tuesdays. And I'm trying to hear what the other one can say about it because it's already out. One bar, the second battery, so let me go ahead and get my first battery, so it's one down to me. Okay, I just changed the battery, the second battery is charging, now it's my first battery, and it's full, 3 bars. Okay, good. Now, in today's case, all I'll be doing is a case of Michelle Martinko. And this case was solved after 40 years, and this case was solved after 40 years, and found the murderer back in 2020, and they arrested since then for 2 years. So, yeah, just Michelle Mary Martinko was born October 6, 1961. Oh, she's a Libra. That's crazy, because I was born October 2nd. My birthday is October 2nd, so I'm a Libra. She was born in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Martinko was the younger of 2 daughters of Albert F. Martinko and Janet Martinko. She attended Cedar Rapids Canadian High School, where she was an above-average student and well regarded by school officials. She was also a talented performer, joined the touring squad as a sophomore, and performed in choirs and theater productions. Not have many close girlfriends or acquaintances, which was speculated to be caused by jealousy from other students over her beauty and stylish clothes, or conflict over boys she had dated. Martinko, who was the senior in high school when she was killed, had plans to hide. On the evening of December 1979, Martinko attended a banquet reckoning concert choir at Sheraton Inn in Cedar Rapids. She wore a black jersey dress and black scarf, black tights and heels and waist length, white and brown rubber jacket, and she carried brown leather purse. After the event, she asked her friend and squad teammate if she wanted to join her on a shopping trip to the Westdale Mall, which had recently opened and where Martinko worked at. Her friend declined, and so Martinko went alone, carrying $180 in cash, intending to purchase a new winter coat. Once there, she pursued the stores and spoke with friends and other people she knew who worked there. She was last seen at 8 or 9 p.m. outside of the store in the mall. At 2 a.m., since Martinko had still not returned home, her father reported her missing. At 4 a.m., police found that Martinko's family attended Grandin 72, the Wick Electra in northeast corner of the mall parking lot by Jason Penny. Martinko was found inside, collapsed over the passenger seat and stabbed to death. Martinko had been stabbed 29 times in her face, neck, and chest. Her hands were defensive wounds, which police said to indicate that she had fought back against a killer. Police determined from the lack of blood outside the car that Martinko had been killed while in a car, and a medical examiner estimated she had died between 8 and 10 p.m. The murder weapon was a sharp-pointed but non-defensively a knife, and the medical examiner could not determine its size. The killer left no fingerprints, which led police to believe that they had worn gloves. A police spokesman said that everyone's instinct is said that it was a guy, but they were not sure of the sex of the killer. Based on the cash found within his purse, police concluded that she had not been robbed. She was fully dressed, and the medical examiner determined she had not been sexually assaulted. Police considered the killing to be a personal in nature based on the number of locations that she suffered. police have few leads and appeal to the public for tips. A police spokesman has been that in the week after Martinko's murder, more than 200 people responded to detectives and appeals concerning the case. Police interviewed numerous people and several were clear of suspicion through use of a polygraph. A juvenile found carrying a knife was interviewed and ruled out a murder as was a shopping center employee who had told police that he enjoyed following women offering store mannequins. Rumors began to circulate about the crime. Some thought that Martinko had received harassing phone calls for her death, but police stated that they did not think so. Another rumor emerged that stalking and stabbing had happened in the following days and that police were keeping a secret, which police denied. For some time, a prime suspect in Martinko's murder was a man who had, the month before, broken into a set of Bradley's friend to kill her children. He was never charged with Martinko's murder. He denied the accusations and DNA evidence followed if he did not match the DNA. In 2012, while serving the last sentence from an unrelated attack, the man died in prison from colon cancer. Controversy arose 5 months after the murder. A woman who was driving by the mall parking lot in the early hours of December 20th came forward with the information. She had looked into the parking lot as she drove by to check for her daughter's car because the daughter worked at the mall and had car troubles before. She claimed to have seen two cars in the lot, one which was Martinko's and a man standing next to the open driver's side door of Martinko's car. She was unsure her information would be any use because she had read that the murder happened between 10 p.m. and midnight, and it was 2 a.m. when she drove by. The woman communicated her information to the daughter, the Secretary of Public Safety Commissioner, and believed that it would be passed to the police if it was the information important. The police never received the information, and the woman did not contact police until months later, when they reissued a call for information connected to the murder. Detectives considered charging the commissioner with failure to pass along information to police, but no charges were pursued. Which I understand, if you're a commissioner, if you find out information that happened, you should have told the police, not keep it a secret, because you don't feel like telling them, or you're just afraid. That's just weird. On June 19, 1980, police received police a composed sketch of a man believed to have killed Martinko, which they formed from descriptions provided by two witnesses and eyewitnesses. They described a white man in his late teens and early 20s, around 6 feet tall, weighing 165 to 175 pounds, with brown eyes and curly brown hair. In the year after the killing, the number of people interviewed by police reached the hundreds of the 30 people were interviewed under eyewitnesses. As the investigation dwindled, a $10,000 reward was offered for information that would lead to the killer. Sidekicks were also consulted early on in the investigation as time went on, the case grew cold. In the mid-1980s, Martinko's father filed a lawsuit against the owners of the Westdale Mall and claimed negligence in not providing reasonable security on the night of the murder. The case was appealed and eventually decided by the Iowa Supreme Court in favor of the mall's owners. Martinko's father, Albert, died in 1995. Her mother, Jeanette, also died in 1998. In 2006, 27 years after Martinko's killing, new cold case investigator working for the Cedar Rapids Police Department received a tip connected to the case. But the tip did not lead to any suspects. The investigator discovered what he believed to be the killer's blood while he was leaving. Reviewing the case files. From that, police were able to build a partial DNA profile. Documents claimed that fewer than 1 in 1 billion people were matched DNA profile. The results were entered into the combined DNA index system, the national DNA database, but no matches were found. Eventually, more than 125 people were had a DNA swab and compared against samples that came from the scene. Out of more than 80 people, potential suspects that have been identified over the years, more than 60 people were tested and cleared of suspicion. In SS3, the images featured a man with blonde hair and blue eyes. The company also produced mentions of how the man will have aged in years since the crime. In a press conference during which a new image was shared, a former classmate of Martinko exclaimed that the face looked like another one of their classmates, but the classmate had been investigated. It was clear based on the name spot several years before. Police received more than 100 tips for following the release of new images. In 2018, the DNA phenotyping company took data that had collected the year before and entered in GD match, a police genealogy website that has been used by law enforcement to solve other cold cases, most famously that the Golden State Killer. GD match returned one person who shared DNA markers for the suspect Martinko's murder, and heard to be likely the killer's second cousin was removed. Sorry y'all, I had to change the camera settings. My feet was hurting. When I do start this film, Drew kind of was still on the floor on my tippy toes, not on tippy toes, but like Chris Rice episodes. I'm tired of that, so now I have my camera, and now I'm over here. You guys can see me, I can see myself, and we are back and better. Now let's continue this video. The company created a family tree starting with four sets of the woman's great-great-grandparents and reported that the killer was most likely descended from one of those couples. Investigated with the set of records, police department contacted DNA testing members of two other branches of the family tree and eliminated three branches as it contained the killer. He then contacted a member of the third branch and DNA test determined that they were first cousins with the killer. The suspect down to a set of three brothers who had grown up in Manchester, Iowa. The three brothers were placed under surveillance and investigators began to attempt to collect DNA secretly. On October 29, 2018, investigators observed one of the brothers, Jay Lynn Burns, drink multiple sodas using plastic straw. When Burns disposed of the straw, the investigator collected it and tested for DNA. Tests eliminated the two brothers as suspects, but the DNA from Burns' straw matched the blood found on Martinko's clothing. On December 19, 2018, investigators went to Burns' business in Manchester, Iowa to interview him for DNA, but was compelled to do so with a search warrant. Hands and arms were also examined for scars possibly left by the assumed cuts sustained during the attack. Burns maintained that he did not know Martinko and was not there. The investigator later testified that Burns did not specifically deny killing Martinko. He was not able to provide an explanation for why his DNA would have been present at the crime scene. According to the investigator, Burns showed almost no emotion or envy even when he was eventually told he was being arrested. When asked if he had killed someone that night in 79, Burns reported investigators tested DNA. When DNA sample was tested, it matched what had been found on the crime scene. Jody Lynn Burns was 25 years old when he killed Michelle Martinko in 1979. He grew up in Manchester, Iowa and graduated from West Delaware High School in 1972. He lived in Manchester at the time of his arrest in 2020, which was 2 years ago, and owned a powder coating business in the state. He had worked for John Deere and co-owned truck stop. Burns had previously been married to Patricia Burns, who died in 2008 from suicide. Burns' cousin Brian Burns went missing on December 19, 2013, and has not been found. Although Burns' arrest in Martinko's case raised questions about the two incidents, police did not believe Burns was involved in either one. Which I kind of was serious about that, because I read that online. I thought maybe he had some of his cousins, you know, decent parents or his previous wife's suicide. On December 19, 2018, exactly 39 years after Martinko's murder, Burns was arrested and charged with the first degree murder. He entered a plea of not guilty. trial hearing, Brent's attorneys claimed that police needed a skip in a search warrant because the DNA from the discarded straw, but the judge determined that discarded property cannot reasonably be considered private. The defense also requested that evidence pertaining to Brent's cell phone and browser history be suppressed. Investigators that reviewed Brent's 2018 internet searches and found that he regularly visited websites showing blonde women being raped, stabbed, and strangled, in which depicted sexual intercourse with murder victims. The judge determined the search history was not usable and tried into decades of time in separating the murder and search after 2 days of jury selection. The murder trial began on February 12, 2020. The prosecution emphasized the likelihood of DNA evidence matching someone other than the person who left at the scene. The doctor performed Martinko's autopsy investigators in the case, all now retired, took the stand to testify to how the investigation was conducted and the Martinko's cause of death. This argued that DNA evidence had been mishandled and that different articles of the clothing from the scene should not have been stored together in one evidence bag. Prosecutors also played videos of the police interview Burns in which he denied being the crime scene of the night of Martinko's murder and could not explain how DNA could have been found at the scene. A alleged recording after Burns' arrest in which Burns questioned whether he had been blocked by the memory of committing the crime. The defense brought only one witness, the self-described forensic consultant who testified on the possibility that police could have been sent out the evidence. He stated that Burns didn't could have been at the scene due to secondary transfer, such as skin cells, transferring to an article of clothing when someone brushes up against another person. Although he clarified that it was not his opinion that this was the case with Burns' DNA. Prosecutors called a criminalist to contradict the defense's witness. The criminalist said that the storage from Martinko's clothing was not unusual. Burns' defense team objected that the wording of one of the prosecution's questions, where they claimed implied publicly that Burns would have been at the scene. The defense requested the case would be declared a mistrial as a result, but the judge denied the question and asked for the prosecutor to rephrase the question. For 2020, after 3 hours of deliberation, the jury found Jalen Burns guilty of first-degree murder in Michelle Martinko's case. Irwin Law amended a life sentence without prejudice of parole for the first-degree murder. On May 29, 2020, Burns' attorneys filed a motion asking for a new trial, claiming his constitutional and states were violated and that the court made a mistake in overruling the request for evidence to be suppressed. On August 9, 2020, Burns was sentenced to life in prison without parole. In September 2020, Burns filed a notice of appeal. Burns is currently in prison in an anomalous state in Cherry. It's crazy how they trying to prison this child, but they had no evidence, but they had evidence of his DNA found at the crime scene of blood back in 1979 of the murder in the car. So I'm glad they found him guilty of first-degree murder because his DNA was there, and they found evidence of a search computer usually about blonde women, rape, and all that stuff. That is disgusting, and that's incredible because he was 25 at the time he killed Michelle. Michelle was 18. So Michelle, she would have been like in her 60s, and you in 50s also. And I'm looking at my phone, but that just crazy how. Imagine walking to the mall by yourself at night and someone just walk up on you and kill you because you're the target. Now I understand why men in general, not the ones that raised, but men in general, love targeting beautiful young women, especially white women with blonde, brown eyes or blue eyes, and determined to kill them, rape and kill them. And for what? For you don't know them. Like, I just don't understand that. You didn't take her money, you didn't rape her, none of that. You just walk into a car and just freaking kill her for no reason. And she didn't deserve that. She was 18 years old. She didn't intend to graduate from high school. She took interest like kids, grandkids, aunts, siblings, and nephews. She didn't get a chance to run a real world experience. She didn't get a chance to go to college yet. And that's unfortunate, because how even girls and females, they can't even go to school by themselves without getting attacked by a creep or getting kidnapped or murdered and no man was named to watch them. Or it's just crazy and it's just sad how you can do any of that stuff. You gotta watch on the surroundings, especially by something more. Let a nightmare show you have someone that with you, because you know when it's going to be my time on earth. And that is unfortunate. So rest in peace, and Michelle Martinko. Thank God the killer is arrested after nearly 4 decades, 39 years. Now it's like 41, 42 years after murder. And now he's in prison, rest of his life. He should have been kind of charged with the murder a long time ago, but didn't have enough evidence to prove that. And it's crazy how long cases been unsolved for years, like 2, 3, 4 decades, and it's been solved. Some has been not even unsolved. Not even solved yet, and that is crazy. So let me guys know what you guys feel about this video. If you have any suggestions on which